greetings. But no man knows the day. I almost cringe inside every time I hear that phrase tossed out. And it is worse when it is a Christian I care for. Yes, that phrase does come from the New Testament, as does Judas hung himself and go thou and do likewise. Both phrases from the New Testament, but it would be idiotic and suicidal to juxtapose them. Matthew 24:36. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. The last time I began to address this subject, I was derailed by the revelation of Matthew 24:5. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Messiah, and they will deceive many. A perfect description of Islam claiming Jesus is the Christ while deceiving everyone who follows it. But let's leave that topic to the video I've already made about that verse. No man knows the day nor the hour. The problem I recognize is the rationalization in the heart that tosses this out. God says you can't know, so don't bother even thinking about it. And if that were the only verse in the Bible on the topic, like the one verse that says, hell was prepared for Satan and his angels, I'd say it was not worth digging into or cogitating on, compared to the many other vital topics called both the milk and the meat of God's Word. Fortunately, it is not the only text in the Word of God which touches the topic. Certainly, let's look first at several verses which reinforce this unpredictability. Matthew 24:42, therefore be alert, since you don't know what day your Lord is coming. 24:44, for this reason you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour when you do not think he will. Matthew 25:13, therefore be alert, because you don't know either the day or the hour. Luke 12:40, you also be ready, because the Son of Man is coming at an hour that you do not expect. So those verses teach that no one knows the hour or the day. And Muslims, get your pencils ready, because I'm going to give you two verses that appear to contradict each other. The first verse of the pair is this, Acts 1:7, and he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. First, you need to understand the context. Acts 1:3, after he had suffered, he also presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. This is Jesus, after his resurrection, proving to them he really was alive. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. This is Jesus confirming the Comforter was coming soon, confirming the time frame to their lifetimes, and refuting Islam's claim Muhammad 600 years later was the promised one. Acts 1:5, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Not many days hence, meaning not long from now. And Jesus again repeats who the Comforter is. Believers, weep and travail for Muslims blinded by the lies of Islam. Show them the word of truth in as much love as you have matured into. Jesus said the Comforter was the Holy Spirit. He repeats it again here when he confirms the promise's soon fulfillment. May God open the eyes of honest and sincere Muslims who want the truth. Acts 1:6. So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom? Notice, They are asking a specific question, and they kept asking it. They were pestering Jesus for an answer to know the future. So he responded with the answer I have already shown. Acts 1:7, and he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. And then Jesus gets right back to teaching them about the Comforter. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. When I read this, I can see Jesus saying, Listen, things happening in days matter more than things 2,000 years from now. But the Comforter who will come in days will cause the 2,000 years of history to happen in the future. So pipe down and listen up. This is very important to you. And oh, by the way, I've only got a few more moments with you. Acts 1:9. And after he had said these things, he was lifted up while they were looking on, and a cloud received him out of their sight. Perhaps Jesus felt the time pressure of his imminent departure. I don't think he was angry, but he knew what needed to be said, just like he always had known. But there are also many other scriptures like this. Luke 21:25, And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Think about those words, because they have implications. You have to be looking to begin to see something. You have to have your eyes open. You have to know what you are looking for. Consider going on a long driving trip across the country. Your child asks, When will we get to Grandma's? They pester you for the first 30 miles. You would tell them, Grandma lives in Boston or wherever. When you see Boston listed on the green signs, we're beginning to get close. But when will we get there? Don't worry about the exact time. It's a long time to go yet. But watch for the signs, and when you see them, you'll know we are close. I don't think I need to know the hour or even the day. I don't think I want to have that knowledge. But my eyes are open, and I know what I am looking for. And I am seeing the signs that mean we are getting close. You can go to sleep in the back of the car if you want to. Oh, right, I promised Muslims a pair of contradicting scriptures. I'm glad you Muslims hung in there for this important contradiction to chortle and cackle and mock God about. 1 Thessalonians 5:1. But of the times and the seasons, brother, you have no need that I write unto you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. You have no need that I write you. I don't need to write and tell you, because you already know the things I would write. When you see the signs, and you already know what signs to look for, look up. Look up. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draws nigh, or near. If you call yourself Muslim, I challenge you to think, brother. The signs that God gave in the Bible are about to be fulfilled. Do you still dare to say God's word was corrupted and changed? Cry out to God, O Muslim, and ask Him for His truth, not Muhammad's. Pray and ask God to show you His light and His truth. And Almighty God, who sent the prophets and Jesus, will hear you and answer you. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.